Hey everyone, good morning. James Azar here with the CyberHub Podcast for your daily practitioner brief. I hope you are having a wonderful Tuesday morning. If you haven't started your day off yet, I hope you're enjoying your good cup of joe. Still recovering from COVID-19, although as you can tell today, my voice feels much, much better. And so I'm grateful for that. Before we get right into our practitioner brief today, folks, make sure you subscribe right now. If you're watching us on YouTube, subscribe and hit the bell button to get notifications every time we post a new video. If you're listening on your favorite podcast listening platform, subscribe right now. And also make sure to give us one of those amazingly important five-star reviews. You can go to our website, cyberhubpodcast.com. There you can get all of the stories I talk about here in great detail with all the links to everything you need to see by going to cyberhubpodcast.com. And now without further ado, let's get right into today's practitioner brief. I've got a few stories I've been monitoring this morning, one of which is starting off with malware. So malware, very, very big deal, obviously. The root cause of a predominant amount of cyber incidents. And here we go, where Pastebin-like web services are now downloading malware, like Agent Tesla, Lime RAT, and spear phishing attacks. So Pastebin, which is a code hosting service that enables users to share plain text through a public post called Paste, currently has 17 million unique monthly users and is extremely popular, apparently, among cyber criminals, such as the Fin5 APT group and the Rocky Threat group, for hosting their payloads and command and control infrastructure. But now more malware and ransomware families are starting to utilize another service with the domain paste.nrecom.net. Service has been around since May of 14, has similar functions as Pastebin. It also has an API powered by an open source PHP-based Pastebin stick that allows for scripting. According to researchers with Juniper Networks, that said that the API feature is lucrative for criminals who can leverage it easily to insert and update their data programmatically. Researchers say that the attacks utilizing the service generally start with a spear phishing email that includes an attachment, like a document, archive, or an executable. The recipient is tricked into opening a malicious attachment, which is typically, as always, the first stage of attack, which then downloads the next stages from paste.nrecom.net. This also tends to overcome any EDR or AV as well, simply because the domain, excuse me, folks, simply because the domain does do that. So, something to really keep an eye on and monitor as we go forth and really try to find different ways. I'm looking at mitigating this by essentially blocking any sort of attachments like that from making it into the inbox, and possibly trying to centralize them within the security team, so that that way if anyone is trying to do that kind of spear phishing attack, we're able to block it on the onset. Fresh wave of phishing emails are using election as a lure. So we're about a little under a month away from the presidential elections, and there's a fresh wave of phishing emails with election related lures that are designed to get users to click and activate the imitated botnet or help harvest user credentials. Know Before has discovered a phishing campaign spoofing the U.S. Election Assistance Commission that's designed to harvest credentials. The imitated campaign, which began 5 days ago, 6 days ago on the 1st, represents the first time that TA542, the gang behind imitated, has used a political angle as a phishing lure. TA542 is using a combination of techniques designed to convince the recipient that the email is from a legitimate source. They're using the Team Blue Take Action Committee as the sender of the email, which is a super PAC by the Democratic Party. They're talking about volunteers, asking people to open a Word document. And then when it does, when they download and open the Word document, imitated is then downloaded on the target's computer. Know Before says that a campaign spoofing the Election Assistance Commission may be part of an attempt by parties unknown to intervene in the election, either by seeding confusion and chaos in the election process or engaging in some form of election fraud, although we judge it more likely that this fish is being used to fuel identity theft and related acts of fraud. The campaign, which was spotted by our friends over at Know Before on October 1st, has not been connected to any group as of yet. The malicious emails carry a message that states your Arizona voter registration application has been reviewed by your county clerk, and some or a few details could not be confirmed. A link takes the recipient to a website spoofing Service Arizona, which is the legitimate Arizona election information site. The fraudulent site has an online form asking for the person's name, DOB, mailing address, email address, social, and driver's license number to harvest the information. So, job well done over by our friends at KnowBefore. Tenda router zero day emerges in a spyware botnet campaign. So two former Tenda routers zero days are anchoring the spread of a Mirai based botnet called TTINT. In addition to the denial of service, the variant also has a remote access Trojan and spyware capabilities. This is a very long story, but Tenda routers are available at big box stores. They're used in homes and in offices, small offices. The first vulnerability is CVE-2018-14558, has been exploited since at least November of last year, but it wasn't disclosed until July. There's now a firmware update to address it. In late August, the second critical Tenda router vulnerability, CVE-2020-10987, emerged in the campaign. It's also rated 9.8 out of 10 in the CVSSS scale, also disclosed in July. It has been tried since January to get a patch, but there's no patch as of yet. TINT as a malware can carry out 10 typical Mirai DDoS attacks and instructions, including multiple attack vectors, along with 12 RET instructions and 22 custom C2 commands that all work together. Something extremely, extremely complex. Again, with work from home being such a big deal now, home equipment is becoming even more critical for us as CISOs to pay attention to. That's something I know I've spent a lot of time kind of researching and trying to create some sort of, you know, kind of best way to manage your home network kind of deal for my staff members. That's it for our practitioner brief here today. More stories can be found on our website at cyberhubpodcast.com. Until tomorrow, folks, stay healthy, and even more so, stay cyber safe.